Hey, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Collider Mailbag on this Sunday. I'm Dennis Zen, and I'm joined by...
me, Natasha Martinez. Hey, guys.
And also...
what's up, man? Man, Sunday.
Yeah.
These days just kind of... they all feel like one day. It's weird. They just like merge together so quickly.
Thanks for you guys coming in early on a Sunday morning so we can do
this
show.
I actually slept here, so.
Okay. I ran around the block for like 24 hours and came back.
So this is a show where we answer your viewer submitted questions. So normally we answer your questions from you guys sending on collidervideo@gmail.com. But today we're going to do a special one, kind of like John's been doing for these past few weeks. I took a bunch of questions on my Facebook page, kind of asking more about behind the scenes questions and also filmmaking questions, because I figured with me and Schnepp here, we can answer some of those. So Natasha, what do we got up?
All right, first up, we got Sam Carrico. What advice do you guys have for someone starting their own movie-related YouTube channel?
For me, it's being consistent, having content consistently. I've noticed that the people who watch YouTube have a voracious appetite for this stuff. And so if you don't have something up... they used to say you need something up like once a week, mm-hmm. but I feel like you need something up like 2-3 times a week now in order to actually get an audience. Because people, like even our shows on Collider, like we do, what, 2-4 shows a day. And even then, like people are like, where's this? Where's that? Where's this? So I feel like if you're going to start a YouTube channel, do a lot of videos. I mean, don't make them crappy, but at least have some consistency. Schnepp?
Yeah, and I would say have consistency in what you're talking about. Like, you know, like if you're going to talk about comics one week, keep talking about comics unless you're like, this is the whatever we talk about is that's what it is show, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like if you want to find an audience then and you found some people who want to talk about comics, then they'll come back and keep, like, you know, you open a rapport with them. Same thing about film or whatever it is you're into. And what you, if you're starting your own channel and it's a YouTube channel, it's because you want to talk about things that you're passionate about. So definitely pick something that you're into and not just because it's popular. So, mm-hmm.
All right, what's next?
Brian Sudfield writes, what cameras and microphones are used when recording any of the Collider shows?
Well, on this set, we have these Rode Procaster mics. They're pretty nice mics. On the Jedi Council one, they're Audio Technicas. The cameras we use are these Canon Vixia HFG10s. I mean, I have to be honest, they aren't like the nicest cameras in the world, but they work and they do their job. So that's the answer.
Okay. Spencer Walsh asks, oh my gosh, I stumbled on your name. Schnepp finished his... that's the only way I can say it. Schnepp finished his documentary. You have Think Hero. The Schmoes continue on the path to get their show back. Sinead has a tiny human, and John has the pride. Do you guys have any other or new projects in development you can share?
At first, I forgot. I skipped over the John has the pride and thought John has pride.
Oh. You know what? Can't be he's got pride.
Like everyone else has these projects, but John, he has pride. He believes in himself. Yeah. Schnepp, do you have any project? I know you're working on a documentary, and we've got a few other things down the line.
Yeah, you know, I've got a new documentary that I'm going to be raising money through Kickstarter again in February. It's all about the comic book worlds that we are all big fans of, the movies and the comic books themselves, and delves into specific topics I don't want to get into too many that you'll find out about in another month when I actually started on Kickstarter. But it's something that I'm really passionate about. So that's really my next documentary that I'm going to work on. And then I've got a comedy superhero series that I'm also working on. So that I'll be pitching. So, you know, whether I pitch it and people end up some larger company buys it, or I just might make it myself, because that's also a really fun thing to do. So I'm in this weird world where I'm also pitching on a very big property right now that I can't talk about. So we don't know if that'll happen. Mm-hmm. So when you get into that, you've done a lot of different things, especially doing my own movie over the last 2.5 years. We worked with a really small crew. It was me, Holly, and a bunch of like 3 or 4 other people. I love that. I love working on something that's like really you can just really get into and make it like truly your own, and also be able to share like exactly what it is you wanted to say. So I think I'll continue on that path.
Yeah, I mean, we love working here, but we also have other outside interests and other things we're working on. I do a lot of sketch videos for Think Hero, but I think the main thing that I'm going to launch in a few months. I got to figure it out. I'm doing a Kickstarter for a web series that I'm working on called Nuclear Salvation. That's a post-apocalyptic type of thing. I've already shot a teaser trailer, but I need to like come up with a budget and all that stuff. So stay on the lookout for that. You know, if you follow me on Twitter, I'll tweet that stuff out. Natasha, what else do you work on besides
here? I just sleep here. Like, this is my life. Well, of course, you know, one step at a time. I just got on here with Collider and I'm loving it. So, you know, building up my reel and, you know, trying to move up the ranks in the hosting world. But I also am like a commercial actress and do modeling on the side. So having audition days often.
Yeah, cool. It seems like we're all really, really busy.
Yes. Yep.
All right. What's next?
Luke Saunders asks, I'm currently about to start my second year of filmmaking in Australia, and luckily it is taking me to Hong Kong in March for the film festival. My question is, how does one get to go to film festivals such as Cannes, et cetera?
The best way to go is if you have a film in one of these film festivals. Sometimes if it's like it's in one of the categories like a feature film, they might fly you out there. If it's a short film, I don't think they're going to pay for your plane ticket. So it's kind of a rough thing. You have to pick and choose. Like, if you're going to go into the film festival market, pick some of the ones that are bigger film festivals, submit your films to them. Or if you just want to go, save up money and go to the bigger ones. Like, those are great ways to meet and connect with people. They also, you know, they have like things like American Film Market here in LA. There's like places where you go to buy films, and you also find a lot of people who are foreign buyers, and you can hang out and meet them. I think it's a sort of like it's a hard way to get into the actual filmmaking like marketplace, so to speak, when you have a short film or a film that's in a festival, because you're basically competing with thousands and thousands and like hundreds of thousands of people. And those are films that no one is going to see except if you're at a film festival. So I've never been a big film festival person myself. I did it when I first started out and then quickly stopped and just started just making my own stuff and, you know, showing my friends.
So. Well, I mean, right now we have Sundance going on. We know some people that went over there. And film festivals also, besides just exhibiting your movies, and it's just a big networking place. People are trying to like meet other people to see if, okay, maybe you can distribute my film, or maybe meet other actors, say, oh, that person was great in that film. Maybe I could, you know, cast him in mine. And so it's just it's one of those things where there's no kind of guarantee of like getting your movie sold or anything like that. But maybe you can get something outside of that.
Definitely.
All right. What's next?
Kylo Ben writes, what's your favorite combination of panelists of the Movie Talk crew to do the show with? Obviously me.
Yeah.
As the host. I mean, no brainer.
For me, to be honest, I probably have to say like Campy and Schnepp, just because with Christian and Mark, I started to do more stuff with them lately, but for the longest time, I haven't actually been on the show with either one of them. So I don't have that rapport. Like me and Schnepp, I, you know, 3 days out of the week, we're talking in the car all the time, you know, and we hang out, and I hang out with John all the time as well. So I feel like I'm just more comfortable with you and Campia.
Yeah. You know, that's a loaded question. Mm-hmm. I don't have favorites, so to speak, because all of us have different chemistry. Like when I first started the show, I came on as a guest, and then like later I would just kind of Skype in because I was working full time on this other, on the Metalocalypse. So sort of like and then moving into, I think it was Grim Fairy Tales. That's when I first started working. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure. Yeah. It's all a blur now. But yeah, I would Skype in. And then when we started doing the show, it was still For Your Consideration, but it was me, you, and Amy Rose and John. So I think, you know, me and Dennis have a really natural back and forth. Me and Campia have a natural back and forth. But Christian and I and Mark and I also have a great natural back and forth. So, I mean, it's all different. You know, with Ellis, it's more, I can be a little more goofier because he's such a goofball. So it's like it makes me goofier sometimes when he's on. Like, I'll be like, hey, what's up, Conjure Club or whatever. I'm like going to be a little bit more goofy with him. But same thing with Christian. He likes to do like, you know, impersonations. Mm-hmm. So sometimes if he starts busting out, you know, and doing like a Robert De Niro, I'll go to my favorite Nick Nolte, because Nick Nolte's kind of the only one I can do, and it sucks anyway. Like, so anyway, where are my Hulk dogs? You know, it's just like, that's what I mean. It's sort of everybody has their own kind of little flavor, and then you interact with them differently. But I don't have any favorites. I think everybody at Collider here is awesome. Yeah.
We're all cool.
Yeah, everyone's cool here.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Daniel Doyer writes, For Grandmaster Schnepp, what was the best and worst thing about making The Death of Superman Lives? What happened, and have you considered making another documentary in the future? Thanks, guys.
So with the best part of doing The Death of Superman Lives, what happened is a two-parter. It's the first part was actually meeting Tim Burton and him giving us the access to his library of all the archives of artwork, but it was at this like kind of, I always describe it as like a Raiders of the Lost Ark, like the tomb when you come in and you're just like, oh my God. It was all of everything that he's ever worked on, but we couldn't film any of that. We just had this certain amount of stuff that he was like giving us access to. So that was like kind of one of those, oh my God moments. And literally, like, I'd say the other favorite part was just kind of just doing the interviews with everybody. It was, for myself, it was such, I had such an interest in like, you know, what happened with this film and why did it fall apart? But as I uncovered it, it was sort of like being a detective, like finding all these different artists who had worked on it. And then they would give me names to the other artists. So finding out more about the process of how the development hell process works with most movies, it kind of echoes the Superman Lives thing. So and the worst part about it was going broke. like five times over the course of 2.5 years. I mean, literally, I did a Kickstarter for it. I thought I could do the film in a certain amount of time. I couldn't get any of the main interviews for almost a year and a half. And then I got John Peters like literally a month before we premiered the movie. So it was really, really difficult to land a lot of these people and convince them to want to be in the film. And because so many people were, it's not only a shelved film, but it's a film that people would laugh at with hatred. So it was like I was dealing with a very uphill battle to try to, number one, get even the people who were involved in it to talk about it with like, you're not going to make fun of me. I'm like, no, I'm not making fun of you. This is not a joke piece. Yeah. And I'm known for making comedic cartoons. That's what my career has been up until this point. So people are like, what are you going to space ghost me or like make fun of me in a weird way? So I was like, you know, it was very hard. And like I said, we ran out of money because it just took so much longer to do. And we had like additional expenses of, you know, like go flying to London, all these different kinds of things that, you know, I didn't know how this was all going to work out. And it's really just trying to keep all this little small team together for long enough to actually finish the production, you know, without everything fraying apart and people running off and taking other jobs and all this kind of stuff. So it was a lot of micromanaging and really just kind of flying by the seat of my pants and like, you know, doing another crowdfunder, or like, you know, getting people involved with or raising money or like loaning money that I'm then paying back. So it was like such a process that I wouldn't say I want to do that again, like go through a process like that again, but I'm definitely working on a few other productions about other films that didn't happen. And, you know, I can announce more later, but that's something that, you know, I'm interested in. And I found out a lot about other films that, you know, as I was making The Superman Lives, I got a lot of access to a lot of other films and things like that. So, I mean, that's definitely something I want to do. A lot of people always say, hey, how come you don't do the Fantastic Four? What happened? Mm-hmm. It's not really, that's less of a what happened about, you know, it not getting made. Mm-hmm. It's more about what happened because it got made. So that's like a nightmare story from a different perspective. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you know, what I'm going to work on next is, like I said earlier, like a narrative kind of superhero comedy series and or movie. I don't know what it's going to be yet. And then I'm working on another documentary, but it's not about, you know, films that didn't happen. It's actually about what our culture is now, the superhero culture, of the positives and the negatives, and what can we do to move forward with it. So,
all right, what's next?
Connor Andrew Lightbody asks, how much of a performance comes from the direction given to the actor?
Some of it. I mean, I've had arguments with people like, oh yeah, the actor just needs to show up and, you know, it's their job. It's like, yeah, it's their job, but you as the director need to actually direct them. That's why you're there. You need to guide them. A director can't turn an actor like from like someone that sucks into like an Oscar caliber, but you can try and bring something out of them and test their limits and bring them to something they haven't done before. And it's all about the way you talk to them and the way, you know, that's why a lot of directors work with the same actors and same with actors and the same directors, because they have some sort of like camaraderie with each other and they know how each other thinks. And I think that's, you know, you can bring that out of them, Schnepp.
Yeah, you know what? It's a rapport that you end up establishing with actors and actresses, whereas they trust you and you trust them. And I think it's different with everybody. Like when I've worked with Nick Offerman several different times, and when I've worked with him, he gets my sense of humor. And so I don't even have to really, because we know each other, so he'll come and do a performance. He'll bring his flavor that I know he's already going to bring. and he knows my sense of humor. So he's, it's kind of like, is this what you were going for? So he's saying it in the way that he knows that'll make me laugh because we're doing something together. And I know he's saying it the way that's why I wanted to work with him. So sometimes you get lucky and you get to, you know these different kinds of actors and actresses that instantly can fit into, like, when I think of, or when I see a script, I think of different actors or actresses that I already know, like, I'm going to ask them, or that would be perfect for this person. Or while I'm writing something, like I'm writing something right now where I've got like five or six actors and actresses in mind to play these roles. And if they don't say yes, I'd be bummed because I'm like, I'm writing it with their thought process and the way I hear them in mind to deliver these lines. So if they say no, then I would have to try to get someone else who can either i.e. replicate that or bring another flavor to it. That's the other answer, is some actors will bring a character to life where you're like, hey, I've read this and I have it this way in my mind, and they'll bring, I have this totally different interpretation of it, check it out. And you do a rehearsal and you're blown away, like, I didn't even see that character like that. You brought that character to life in such a different way that now you've burned that character into my mind and I can't see it in any other way. Sometimes it's the opposite, where the actor is like, well, what do you want? What do you see? How do you want? I never read anybody in. Like, reading someone in is like basically, say it like this.
Yeah, like you, like, do a voice reading, or
do an interpretation, yeah, of the way a thing, an inflection. That's not your job. Your job is directing them. You're not reading. That's my I don't like to, yeah, do that. So I don't do that. So it's such a back and forth. And that's the greatest thing about working as a team. Movies, television, any kind of things like this is a team effort. So you have to be totally into working with people and having a back and forth. And that's the greatest thing about directing and the greatest thing about working with actors.
Yeah, and you mentioned trust. Trust is a big factor.
100%.
Because you want to make the actor comfortable. Mm-hmm. The more comfortable they are, the more they're willing to push themselves and do things maybe they weren't going to do.
You're just going to get a better performance out of, yeah, somebody who feels comfortable and they feel like you've got them. You know, they're not like out on a limb. They're like, go ahead and commit suicide. Yeah. I'll just watch it. Yeah. You know, you're like, no, this is the perfect thing you're doing. You know, you gotta have that back and forth.
Yeah, you can't be sitting there like ready to yell at them or like, right, oh man, you better hurry up, right, with your, you know, performance because, right, we got to get out of here. It's like, you know, no one wants to be on that kind of,
totally,
stress level. All right, what's next?
Gisberto Guzzo writes, my question is about movie budgets and why we don't see too many mid-budget films, $60 to $80 million for adults. It feels like studios are only interested in making big-budget franchise films or micro-budget indie films.
Right.
I think it's harder to get people to the theater nowadays, so they have to have these big budget spectacles, right? Like a Star Wars, and even like, you know, Mad Max or something that benefits you seeing it on a giant screen with awesome sound, you know, and with an audience as well. Right. And so now these mid-tier movies that are made for adults, it's a lot harder to get people to come out and pay for those. And those now live in television. Mm-hmm. So a lot of that market, and you'll see some of the actors go there. Even actors who are huge movie stars will go to television maybe to do like a one, like Oscar Isaac, he did a Show Me a Hero on HBO, a limited series, you know? Mm-hmm. That guy was in a bunch of, you know, he was in Star Wars, The Force Awakens, but they choose to do some smaller projects on the side. So what do you think?
Well, I mean, the marketplace is a different animal than it was 10 years ago and a completely different creature 20 years ago. So we're in this weird digital transformative space right now where, like, even 5 years ago, we didn't have Netflix and Hulu and Amazon and all these choices. And we also, I mean, streaming and all these kinds of things that we have, like our phones, we can watch things on our phones, and attention spans have diminished. So it's sort of these kinds of things that we're fighting, as well as box office. Studios make movies to make money, and that is the biggest thing. So when you have mid-level films that are not performing, and mid-level films have not been performing for years, that's why you see the diminished results and the diminished returns, i.e. diminished films not happening in the $50 million range. You see them at like, look, we could do this for $10 million, or we could do this for $15 million, because when we sell it across the globe, we can make enough money back that even if it plays here in the U.S. and it only makes $2 million, which is normally what independent films only make, they make $2, maybe $8 million. And you're like, well, how much did it cost? You're like, it cost $15 million. Well, then it's at a loss, but they're like, no, we sold it overseas for this, that, and the other. So selling and making a film is an incredibly giant and complicated process just from the get. So, you know, when you're like, oh, there's no more $50 million movies. The reason is they can't compete with $100 million movies, because $100 or $150 million movie also means it's marketed everywhere. Mm-hmm. And that movie is like, it's an Avengers or it's a Star Wars.
It's a mass appeal.
And that movie's going to take your movie. Like, if your movie's opening that weekend, it's going to eat your movie. It's going to, I just ate you for breakfast. Mm-hmm. You're like, your movie's not going to perform that well. It's limited theaters. It's limited. So you're even lucky if you're in one of those big, one of the big complexes. You might be in like the smaller theater run, the smaller chains. And you're right, Dennis. People are not going to see movies as much as they did now, because those $50 million movies have been put into exactly where we see them now. On like, oh, I'm watching Netflix House of Cards. It's like an extended, like, oh, it costs $50 million, but now I get like 7 hours of it instead of two. So we as viewers and consumers of these kinds of products are winning, because we get to see a little bit more of that story that's told. Whether or not it was like, oh, it worked perfectly when it was 2 hours, now we're seeing extended 10-hour series that could have just been a movie, but it's a different way of telling stories now, and that's where we're at. And that, it's not going to go backwards. It's only moving forward. So we're going to see, just like Spielberg and Lucas said a few months ago, we're going to see bigger and bigger event-style films taking up our box office, and then we're going to see that transition that we're already in, where we have $50 to $80 million movies. Those are already gone.
Yeah.
Those are done. So we see, like, you talk about the Blumhouse. Hey, I spent $500,000 on this, like, horror movie. It's got a lot of jump scares. Even those now are jumping right to Netflix. They're not even bothering. Like, three of them just opened yesterday on Netflix. I saw, like, well, these three new horror movies, they're all from Blumhouse. They're all, like, 2015. They're like, you know, bam, we're going to get that money back from like rentals and Netflix. It doesn't even have to go, because we didn't spend that much money. The movie cost $500,000. Why are we going to put all these ads and all this other stuff? All the ads, and that's like $2-3 million. It's way more than the movie cost. We could rock that just alone with the, you know, the SVOD people purchasing it and then seeing it on Netflix. So that's kind of where it's going. So sorry to say that big budget movies, long-winded as I was, are gone.
Well, so, also, speaking of Spielberg, you had, when he was doing Lincoln with Daniel Day-Lewis, he said it was this close to becoming an HBO movie. So you're talking about Steven Spielberg, one of the greatest directors of all time,
right.
Daniel Day-Lewis, one of the greatest actors of all time, about a subject matter that is pretty, Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah.
And they barely got that movie made, you know? And because it was one of those $60, $70 million drama period pieces that's not made for spectacle, so you're not bringing in those, you're not selling Abraham Lincoln toys or posters, you know what I mean?
Based on reality, it wasn't like Abe Lincoln Vampire Hunter. What a big pile of poo that was.
So they have a hard time, you know, getting those movies. If those two have a hard time getting a movie made, then imagine everyone else. And then on the flip side of that, you know, you mentioned Netflix and House of Cards. You know, I talk to my friends who are, a lot of them are all married and they have kids. They only go to the movies maybe 2 or 3 times a year.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
So they've got to pick. So what are they going to see? They're going to pick like something like a Star Wars or whatever, right. An Avengers or something like that. And what they will do is they'll go on Netflix and watch all these TV shows. They always talk to me about like House of Cards, Game of Thrones, Walking Dead, Breaking Bad, all those things. Like, but when I talk to them about movies, they're like, no, I haven't seen that one.
Right.
No, I haven't seen that one. No, I haven't seen that one.
No, that's very true. I mean, it's a really hard area. Like, I'll wait for Netflix, as I constantly hear. I'm waiting for it to just come online. That's the new thing. I'm not going to go see that. I'm going to wait for it to come online. It has to be something, which is exactly why you might ask why these movies are going away. It's because of just this process, and it's just a natural change as theaters are not making the money back on those $50 million movies, and the audience is deciding to wait for Netflix. That's exactly why it's happening.
All right, what's next?
Brock Emmerich writes, "What was the craziest experience you had while working on a film project?"
Schnipp.
Craziest experience. You know, like I would say overall, working on Metalocalypse. Just going and hanging out with all the bands, because we would have the death metal bands do voices for our TV show, but usually it would coincide with them playing a concert here in Los Angeles. So we would all go out and get heavily hammered and hang out with the band. So that was like pretty fun. We had some pretty fun times doing that. And it was about crazy. I've never been in a high speed chase or somebody trying to kill me on set. So like that kind of crazy hasn't happened. Don't want it to happen.
No, I never had anything that crazy. I mean, I used to coordinate the shoot for the Producers Guild, and that was kind of crazy in the sense of not crazy things happen, but just trying to coordinate filming in all these different areas with all these different people speaking and having all that stuff and just gathering all. Yeah, it was just kind of fun because we would just load right in and we have to set everything up and then shoot the next day for 2 days. And it's like, it's just crazy how much people don't realize, like, just those simple things, how long everything takes, you know, and sure. how easily things can go wrong really quickly.
I just thought of one thing. Like, earlier in my career, I was doing this crazy science fiction comedy series, and one of the actors showed up on set on acid.
Oh my
it was
God.
Literally like, and so it was like just getting, it was like, we're just going to get through this. Let's just do line by line. It was really a very interesting experience. We were able to actually use about 35% of the, you know, of what the lines were. And then some of the other lines were just like, that's a good improv that's going in there. So very weird experience.
Okay. I guess I remembered something. So when I was filming the teaser trailer for that web series I was talking about, Nuclear Salvation, we were shooting it down at the Salton Sea, and we're shooting this empty it's abandoned. It's like, you know, run down. Like, you're not really supposed to be there.
Right.
But I guess as we were filming it, me and a couple of the actors and someone helping, and I had the makeup artist, she was in the van waiting, and I guess we see like the cops come.
Mm-hmm.
And we're like, oh shit, let's hide all our stuff, you know what I mean, because we had like prop guns and all that stuff. We're like hiding everything, and then I guess that when they came up and started talking to us, they actually didn't care that we were shooting there. What right. they were worried about is that to make sure that we weren't dumping bodies. Apparently that place was
oh my god,
apparently that place was known where people like go there and bury some bodies there,
because
they were like, they're like, just make sure you guys leave before it turns dark.
Wow. I was
like, okay.
Oh my god.
You don't want to meet the dumpers.
Yeah. Exactly. So
that's,
I guess
so
that
scary.
Was
that's
kinda
pretty
crazy.
Awesome.
All right, what's next?
Joaquin Zuniga writes, why don't you guys have snacks and alcohol when doing the show anymore?
Just because I don't think it would be a good idea.
Yeah. Who's to say this isn't filled with vodka?
Yeah, I don't think people want to hear us chewing on food.
Yeah. No.
While we're talking.
Yeah, crinkling and doing all this other kind of stuff. Yeah, it would be distracting. Or even while we're talking, like, say you guys are talking, yeah. I'd just be like, eating Doritos into the mic. That would suck.
Yeah, and then alcohol, like, I feel like it would just, maybe we get, I think alcohol is good for getting people a little loose.
Yeah.
But once you start drinking a little too much, people get a little too free.
Yeah.
With their. And
well,
then,
we are going to be doing that new series, Collider After Dark,
yeah.
which we'll all be hammered on. But, you know, that'll be through our paywall where, you know, you have to pay money to see that. Yeah.
I think the most you'll see is like when maybe we do the Oscars thing.
Sure.
You'll see us drinking alcohol and.
Yeah, I
snacks.
Certainly hope The Martian wins for best comedy, because yes. that's what I'm rooting for on the Oscars. Yeah. Yeah, I'll be hammered.
All right, what's next?
Gisberto Guzzo writes, my friend and I recently watched The Long Goodbye, and it led us into a discussion about how it can take a while for a film to have its true reputation be established. Perhaps the film just needed more people to see it, a chance for rewatches, and or a chance for it to transcend its time period and to be able to stand alone as a work of art, timeless or not. Are there any examples that you can think of where the reputation of a film changed for the better or worse after some time had passed?
Well, it's funny you mentioned Long Goodbye. It wasn't a failure. Mm. It just wasn't like a smash out, like, oh, $100-200 million hit. It made its money. I saw it in the theater when it came out and I loved it. I was like, this is great. You know, this is like Sam Jackson wasn't a megastar yet, and neither was Gina Davis. And I believe it was directed by Rennie Harlan, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Shane Black wrote it. It's a really fun film, but it's that kind of thing that, like, when it came out, all of the people involved were not named talent yet. They were like middle talent. So it was like they were growing their talent. Now all of those names are household. You know, like Shane Black, you know about him from Iron Man. Sam Jackson's been in everything. Gina Davis, she's a television star now, more so than a movie star. And who else? And Rennie Harlan, yeah, he kind of, you know, Treasure Island really screwed him up. We go back to that director's question. Remember, you're like, if your film completely bombs, who gets to take that flavory credit? The director, Rennie Harlan, just shattered. They're like, get out of here.
The one movie I can think of that reputation has changed over time is Zodiac. Remember when Zodiac came out? People were crapping on it because, you know, it was Fincher, you know,
yes.
and they're like, they were expecting something else. And a lot of people, that movie's boring, that movie sucks, right. It didn't do... I don't think it was a bomb, but it didn't do that well at the box office. It was depressing. And now a lot of people, including myself, that watch it, it's like, yeah, this is a fantastic movie. It's very well done, all well acted, paced, you know, pretty well. And so I think that's a movie that people's minds have changed over
time.
That's
a fantastic film. One that I'll bring up is John Campia's favorite, Blade Runner. Because I don't think John's ever seen it all the way through, but I will watch that movie with him. Blade Runner, when it came out, I mentioned it earlier, it's a box office bomb. It wasn't like all the kids, including me, because I was a little kid when it came out, I was like, I want to see Harrison Ford with lasers. And it was an adult movie, adult science fiction, had nothing to do with flying around a spaceship. It was not Star Wars or Raiders of the Lost Ark. It was actually an adult film. It had nothing to do with we're going to be a giant franchise. It was a one-off film. It was based on a very famous science fiction film, a science fiction book called Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? Remember, this is 70s and 80s when you could take chances in movies. There were still a middle budget. There were still people going to see, adults were going to see movies because they were adults, and it was not about bring everybody, it's a musical. It was actually, let's go see something that's going to make us think, and we could talk about the movie after we've seen it. We don't just forget about it like we've been zombied or something. So Blade Runner was it just wasn't well received at all, critically or in the box office. People stayed away from it because they were it's a bummer. It's about androids who are kind of alive, and then they die at the end. Harrison Ford's some gumshoe detective. He's not whipping people with a whip. He's not jumping around. He's kind of depressed. He's flying around in a weird, it's always raining. So I don't think people got it. I don't think people got it culturally when it came out. I think it was so far ahead of its time that it took another 10 years for it to actually become a cult classic. Mm-hmm. So when I saw it again, stoned out of my mind in college, I was like, this is the best thing ever. And it's a couple of years later, they did that director's cut, saw it again in the theater. You know, it was like, this movie is incredible. It's one of my favorite science fiction films because it brings up so many adult themes. What is it to be human? What is life really about? All these different really cool things that most of the time you can't really get deeply into when you're doing we're doing an event film. We'll touch on it, but we're just no, let's move on to the next scene. You know, it's a different style of filmmaking. And I don't think that kind of style of filmmaking is done, but we can see more of that now in television series. Mm-hmm. So Netflix just announced Altered Carbon, which is a great, crazy kind of neuromancery, kind of cool science fiction. And originally I thought about it as it would be a great movie. Now it's going to be a 10 episode series. I cannot wait to see that. I think that's where that kind of world exists now. But Blade Runner now is really esteemed. Mm-hmm. Everyone talks about, Blade Runner this, Blade Runner that. It's but when it came out, people were like, this sucks. Everybody hated it. And it was a bomb. So,
all right. What's next?
Kenneth Britton asks, who do you think has the worst taste in movies on the crew?
I'm not going to, it's kind of like with that favorite crew.
Definitely
thing.
Mark Ellis. No, just kidding.
I'm not going to say worst taste, but I would say, I would say Mark Ellis's tastes are probably the most different than mine out of anyone on the panel. Mm-hmm. So I'm not saying worst. I'm just saying his is the most divergent from mine.
Yeah, I'm definitely a big giant nerd. So it's my tastes are in science fiction, horror, definitely comedy. I like thrillers, I like dramas. I couldn't really compare my tastes. So that's what's so great about talking to you or John or any of the crew that we've had on. We're all different enough where it's we're not going to instantly be in lockstep with each other. Yeah. You know, especially if we both like this one movie, but then all of a sudden another movie, we're like, no way, you know? So I think that's
a
good
thing. Or even movies that we do mutually like, you can come at it from a different perspective. You can I like it because of these reasons,
right,
and you like it because of these reasons. So it doesn't necessarily, even if you like the same movie, it could be for various reasons.
Definitely.
All right, what's next?
Robbie Navarro asks, do you guys consider or accept volunteers to help with the show?
No. I mean, this is kind of a thing where we, it's professional environment. As goofy as we get, we still have to get our work done.
Right.
And I think John touched on the whole internship thing. It's you can't do that. You can't just have people come in and help you for free. You need to have people on staff. So I think just legally wise and professionally wise, we can't do that.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, it's always funny, like, because there's all the behind the scenes people, like Jonathan is rocking the switcher right now. He's totally professional. It's like, it's great to have people who work with all of us who have like done this stuff, know this stuff, and are also cool. So it's hard when people like, and I get it. People want to get that break. They want to get that chance to get in and do something. It's the same thing as like, how do I start a website, or how do I do this, or how do I become a filmmaker, or go into a film festival. You got to put yourself out there in a way, but it's also you can't just walk in. So it's got to be something like do a web show, do a YouTube thing, get an audience, then like, hey, watch my thing. I've got, you know, like 10,000 people are watching my thing. And then you'll be like, all right, let me check that out. Maybe eventually Dennis will be like, hey, this one person, they're really cool. Check out their thing. So it's getting on the radar. It's that kind of process. If you want to get in the behind the scenes thing, I'd recommend doing the same exact thing. Like get into the editing process, get into like cutting videos, cutting stuff, doing digital stuff, getting YouTube, you know, hey, I can show you my reel, this kind of thing. It's like internships on this kind of level don't really work out. So
I will say I met someone who actually is working with me now on my Think Hero sketches. His name's Barrett. I met him at a seminar for cinematography, but that was different because he's, you know, to go to the cinematography thing, you're paying a lot of money for it, and it means you're serious and you're actually doing work. Right. And so I asked him to help out on some sketches, and now he helps out on some of my stuff. So, but that was a circumstantial type of
sure.
thing.
But yeah, what he just said, like, look at these things that are like, hey, I want to be a cinematographer. You're going to have to pay $500 to get into that seminar. Yeah. And then while you're there, if you're serious and you have the way to back up whatever you say, like I'm sure if someone walked up to you at a seminar, Dennis, you'd be like, yo, Dennis, what's up? I watch your show on Movie Talk.
Well, that's what he said, though. He was like, oh, I watch your show on Movie
but
Talk.
But then he had something to back it up.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I'd love to work with you. Here's like the things I've done. Check this stuff out. All of a sudden, you feel more comfortable about reaching back out to them. So yeah. That's that process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. What's next?
Matthew Chinkey writes, how do you guys get your advanced screenings? And do you have any advice for someone trying to make it in the film business but doesn't live in the U.S.? He lives in Canada.
Advanced screens, we usually get emails from the PR reps from different studios saying, hey, we have a screening at this time, would you like to go? Sometimes we can. I think right. I got one for The Finest Hours next Tuesday mm-hmm. night, but I think I'm working here. So in terms of trying to make it outside of it really depends on what you want to do. I mean, do you want to be a filmmaker? Do you want to be an actor? Do you want whatever? But I mean, you can do stuff in your place, wherever you are, gather a group of friends or you know, look on Craigslist or Facebook and trying to find people in your area that you right. can work together and just work on stuff and shoot stuff. Because the truth of it is the first, I don't know, several dozen things that you're going to do are going to suck ass.
Right. Yeah. You're from Canada right now. Do what Campia did. Move to LA. Get out of Canada. So, honestly, though, if you want to get into the film biz or the TV biz, you got to make that choice. It's a hard choice. You got to move away. You got to move to New York. You got to maybe move to Atlanta because that's where they're shooting a ton of stuff right now. You will get a job if you move to Atlanta, Georgia. I guarantee you will. If you want to be a PA and you want to work on Spider-Man, you could probably do that, but you have to be in Atlanta. You have to live there because you're not going to get paid anything and you're going to be getting people water and coffee, but you're going to get to know all these people. And if you're cool and you're friendly, you might get to work on the next movie. So that's what you have to be, is in the right place. And then you have to have your checklist. You have to actually be a cool person. Look in the mirror. Are you cool enough to like interact with a bunch of people and not freak out and start crying? Or will you be able to do the job? You just have to be able to do the job and be, you know, consistent. Don't suck at what the people are asking you to do. That's a test. Nobody knows who you are. You're a production assistant. You've got to be good about doing all this stuff. Because people, when they hire somebody, even if it's for free, they're like, I need help. That's what it's all about. I'm working on this thing. I don't have enough of a budget. That's where production assistants come in. And eventually, if you're a great production assistant, all of a sudden, what happened? Now you're getting paid. Now you're a line producer. Now you're this. Now you're that. You move up the ranks. But you have to be there. So I'm not even joking when I say you have to move. I just came from Florida at a Comic-Con, and people were like, well, how do I break into this or that? I was like, A, move out of Florida. Because I'm like, there's nothing wrong with Florida, but there's the business part of it that's not happening, or established links, especially if you're doing like website stuff. You have to start to find those, you know, find the communities Like, if you, let's use an Florida as an example. I'm like, find the communities of, you know, actors and theater shops and people who are actually doing things, performing, and get in with them so that you have a community that you can work with. You can't be by yourself. You have to do it with a community. That's what all of this is community. It's like media is all community. It's not just you. So I would highly recommend getting into some kind of group, not group therapy, but a group. So.
You might need group therapy after you get into this business, because this business is not for the timid. It's not for the weak.
Nope.
All right, what's next?
Ty William asks, I am taking journalism for college next year. What other courses would you recommend to help get me into your line of work?
What do you want to do? You want to be in front of the camera? You want to be behind the camera? If you want to be behind the camera, the first things I say is learn how to edit. Editing is video editing right now is like almost as important as like word processing skills.
Yeah.
You need to know how to edit, because a lot of jobs, not a lot of jobs, but a lot of jobs in this industry require a lot of editing and a lot of one man band type of stuff.
Totally.
Like, you got to go shoot something and then you got to edit. Also be in front of the camera at the same time. Like, right. You have to do all these different things.
Yeah. Multiple hats. You just come with, I do this, I do that, I do this. And be acceptable to all those things. Cause people, that's you want somebody who wears multiple hats. It's great. I've worked with so many different people who do After Effects and edit and can do title graphics and help with color, minute color correction. It's like, it's that kind of across the board thing where it's like, I can't do everything. I want people who I'm working with who can help me do everything. So if I could work with somebody who's can do these five things or work with these three people who have just the only one thing, I would pick the one person who could do the five things. So
yeah, I mean, I took film studies in college and that helped me think the way I think about films, but everything else I had to learn on my own in terms of like, all the technical and production stuff. Natasha, you took a broadcast journalism.
Yeah. I got my degree in broadcast journalism. And one of the things that people normally ask me is like, oh, as a host, like, what should I do? Should I take hosting classes? And yeah, you could take hosting classes, but along the lines of what you said, Schnapp, was the more hats that you wear, the more valuable you are, and the more, I don't know, the more people are willing to work with you, and you're not just another person that's like, I want to have an opinion and be on camera and look nice. Like, you have to write, you have to shoot your own stuff, you have to edit your own things. So whether that's with internships or outside courses outside of your degree, anything helps, like experience over, you know, something on paper. Like, yeah.
And even here, like sometimes I, you know, Wendy usually helps out with this, but sometimes I take out the trash, you know what I mean? Like, you just got to do everything.
I try not to create trash and I put it in the garbage can.
All right, what's next?
I try.
Another question from Matthew Chinkey. Could you explain in layman's terms the difference between sound editing and mixing?
Do you want to talk about this?
Sure. Let's go layman's terms, sound editing and mixing. So sound editing is basically like, hey, I've got my, you know, we just filmed this, but now I want to make it sound like we're all underwater. Yeah. So first I would like take all of these tracks that are just probably it's a two-track thing, throw that in there. Then I might apply some kind of very minimal filter. I duplicate the track, and then on the tracks 3 and 4, I'd apply some kind of like maybe slightly garbled, like some kind of, I'd apply that to all of our voices. Then I would apply like some kind of oxygen tank sound effect that I could just loop where it'd just be like some kind of bubbly thing. That'd be tracks 4 and 5. Then I would apply some other kind of like, you know, almost like a underwater oceany type of, you know, when you're underwater, you hear that. So all 8 of those tracks I would have, and I would put those in. That's sound editing. Sound mixing is I would give that to some other dude, because I would, I can't be like, sound mixing is an art. And that's like, that's an art that I don't personally have down, because that's like listening to all of the levels and making sure, like, let's say, for instance, I'm making it very simple. 8 tracks is not that rough. I could do it. I'd be like making sure tracks 1 and 2 of all of us, that's the loudest. Then the 3 and 4 with the bubbly that I added, that'd be probably halfway, 50%. So it would meld with the loudest one, and the loudest one would then become 75, and this would become 25. Bam, right? You got that science. Then you got these other 4 tracks, which are just kind of sound design and sound effects. What I would do is I'd put edits in between all of them. So while we're all talking, I do soft dissolves. So it would lower while she's talking. And then if there was a pause in between her and Dennis, I might raise it a little bit, but it would all be cross dissolved, just so you'd have that constant flow there, but not maybe not too much. So that's kind of that thing. But then the sound mixer would take all of that. If you had, say, 24 tracks, which stuff, you know, when you're working on stuff and you're sound designing, you can get deep with that stuff and you're adding all different kinds of sound design and it's all got to be on separate tracks. That's where sound mixing comes in. They're actually applying, they could be doing a 5.1 mix where they're like making stuff move around. It could be from scene to scene where they're keeping a consistency. That sound mixing is like applying the final sound mix that then everyone will hear either on TV or in theaters.
Yeah, from what I heard, like sound editing is actually more of the creation of the sounds.
Correct.
Where sound mixing is you're doing the levels. And people have to understand like a lot of the sounds that you hear in movies were not recorded on set. They were all recorded later on or taken right. from libraries or all this other stuff. Like most of this, only like some of the on-set dialogue is recorded and used, but most of those sound effects are all like taken from somewhere else.
Yeah, giant, vast libraries. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, that's the great thing about sound design is like sometimes people pride themselves with like, yo, I use, you know, I've got this library. And you're like, oh, that's a good, because there's like certain libraries that are just everybody's got the car whistle or the, like there's certain sound effects you're like constantly hearing the same one. You're like, can't you get a new sound effect? And then other people are like, yo, I got this brand new library, yo. It's like, it's got the click. I haven't heard that. It's slightly different. The muzzle sounds, you know. So when you find select sounds that are actually different than the ones that a million people have heard, and also this only comes with time. If you've never done any sound editing before, you just like pop in that, like, you know, the McDonald's sound effects library. You're like, hey, this is great. And but everyone else who's actually done sound editing is like, yeah, you got this McDonald's sound library. Why don't you go back to school, you know? So it really does take, like, you got to mix, you got to pick and choose, I think. So
yeah. All right, what's next?
Patrick McCarthy asks, what is the best software you guys use to produce your daily shows?
Well, for our daily shows, we use Wirecast, which is, you know, not actually that expensive. I think you could pay like $200-$300 for it, and mm-hmm. that helps switches our camera. And then we use Premiere to edit, do any post-production stuff on there. So, all right, what's next?
Bernie Rokotansky asks, why do you think some filmmakers want to stick with film instead of digital and save costs?
That's a big question.
Yeah, it's a big question. I mean, people use film because they like the look of it. I personally don't have anything wrong with people still using film. However, I do have a problem with people who are like, oh, you only can shoot on film. You can only do that. It's like, I don't think shoot on film is the most important thing when it comes to telling a story. When you're watching a movie or a television show, that people don't watch it and go, oh man, you know, this is great because it's shot on film, or this is great because it's shot digitally. All the other factors for me are much more important. I do know film costs a lot more. When you get to the high budget levels, like a Chris Nolan on Interstellar and he shoots on film, it doesn't really matter anymore.
Right.
The cost is negligible. But when you're on the lower end and you're doing indie stuff, definitely digital is way cheaper.
You know what's interesting? Like there's a film that's on Netflix right now. It's called Tangerines.
Yeah.
And it made a lot of waves because it's the first film, feature film, story-wise, that was shot on an iPhone that, you know, won a lot of, I think it was, maybe it was Sundance last year. It was at a festival last year, and now it's on Netflix. Very funny, very crazy, music-driven story about some transvestites on the corner of Santa Monica, just kind of like, I'm going to get this guy. And so it's like this, you know, like revenge film kind of thing. Highly recommend it because it's crazy and weird and surrealist and fun, shot completely on an iPhone. One of the things that stuck out to me is there's a sequence where there's an actual video artifact in, because I, you know, if you edit, you'll see stuff that sometimes people won't see. So I saw just one of those video lines right in the middle of the frame, and they left it in there, and it's a conscious choice. It's one of those things where, or at least I prefer to think it, maybe the director's like, oh, he's mentioning the thing that bothers me the most. Sorry if it was unintentional, but if it was a conscious choice to be like, look, I'm declaring that this is video by saying I'm leaving this scan line, which is a digital artifact, in the middle of this shot. I could have just duplicated the frame. I could have, by, you know, take a slice of the top and the bottom and move it down. It would have taken maybe 15 to 20 minutes to fix that, but instead it was I choose to think it was like on purpose to say this is digital. So sometimes it's a declarative thing. I don't know if it goes that meta or if the character, you know, the that's true or not. But to me, at least, I was like, wow, it really is declaring itself to be a part of this new digital cinema by leaving that frame in. I myself personally feel like shooting in something like 70mm, like what Quentin did with Hateful Eight, if you're able to see it with a great projector and someone called a projectionist, they used to have these things back in the days, who knew how to operate the projection system. It's a monstrous beast. It's this giant machine that's like the heat of a sun that's like burning enough so that it can project through the film so that you can actually see this massive frame on a giant screen. There's nothing like film. And if it's well lit, it's well shot, it looks beautiful, it has that kind of depth, it has that texture, it has that that most of the time you can't get with video. But nowadays with video, some of these cameras, like we were just talking about the Canon, the new one, the Canon one, the C100, mm-hmm. like that has that kind of ability that if it's well lit and you can actually get that proper depth that you usually couldn't get with video. Video, when it first came out, was very much everything that was reflective. Everybody looked plastic. Everything looked gross. And you're what is this alien thing?
When Lucas did Attack of the Clones, that was, I think, the first major digital film that was shot on digital and released. I mean, back then, right now, like I mentioned before, like something like my cell phone now probably takes better video than what they were doing back then. Right. It's just the process. I mean, for me, like seeing The Revenant, you watch it and they shot it on the RE65. That thing is gorgeous. So I don't know. For me, I just feel like it's more of a choice for the filmmaker and what they want it to look like. But ultimately, there's just a lot more important things.
Yeah. Like I agree with you that Christopher Nolan or Quentin Tarantino can afford to shoot in 65 or 70 mm-hmm. millimeter, even 35. For myself, would I like if I was like, here's, $5 million, I think if I was limited and I was like I had a lot of things to do, I would not spend it on the film and the processing. I would spend it on getting as best of a DP as I possibly could get who could emulate and make the shots that I wanted to look great.
All right, what's next?
John Luis Rodriguez asks, Dennis, since you carpool with Schnepp, what are your conversations usually like? And does he ever sing to you while you're stuck in traffic?
No, he doesn't sing. Our conversations are a lot like our conversations on Movie Talk.
Right?
We talk a lot about movies, television shows. If it's on Monday, we usually are like, hey, what'd you do this weekend? Yep. That type of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, once in a while we get into some gritty stuff like, man, Mark Ellis, what the hell? How did he get into Conja Club?
Yeah.
So, but no, honestly, it's like, yeah, I mean, we're just hanging out, talking as like getting ready for the, we might talk about some of the show notes that are upcoming up. Opinions on stuff. I mean, it's literally what just like, hey, all you people out there who have friends. Maybe it's what you guys talk. It's really literally like just some pals hanging out. So
yeah, we talk a lot about movies and TV because, honestly, I live and breathe. That's what I do in my free time as well. It's not like, as soon as I leave here, like, that's it. I'm not going to. It's like, no, that's basically what I do.
And also, it's like Dennis is a friend of mine, so I appreciate him as a sounding board. Sometimes I'll ask him, like, yo, dude, I had this crazy idea. What do you think of this? Or I'll throw stuff at you. Sometimes you're like, oh, man, like, I'm so tired. I'm like, check this out. It's some weird idea. And sometimes you're like, I hear the, all right. You're like, all right, what is this again? So it's fun. We always have fun. It's like a 20 to 30 minute drive. Yeah. So,
and then sometimes we stop by McDonald's.
Sometimes we rock a McDonald's. Yo, yo, Egg McMuffin, son.
All right, what's next?
No meat for me, but
Sam Macias asks, is it annoying or funny when people on social media try to get into arguments with you on any subject in film? And have they ever got intense?
It can be both. It depends. I mean, you know what? Sometimes people say stuff and it's like, you're not making any sense. Like, I can't like even argue with you. And then sometimes they argue with you about certain things. And yeah, it can get a little heated, but I try my best to try and keep it as civil as possible. Sometimes it's a little hard. And it's funny though. Sometimes if someone says something like racist or even just like F you, Dennis, like that doesn't bother me. Cause it's like, well, you're just calling yourself out. I actually get more bothered when people misinterpret what I say. I say something and they're like, they take it completely the wrong way.
Yeah, for myself, like, if somebody's like saying dumb stuff, I don't comment or I don't respond to it. But if somebody's saying something that's actually a good question or has a real earnest thing, sometimes like people get pissed because I like stuff on Twitter. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean like I don't have time to answer all of these questions, and it's no disrespect. It's like if I like it, that means I'm like, hey, but you're right. But if it's like this a question that's very in depth, it's like I just don't have time right now to respond to it. Sometimes I will go back and respond, but most of the time you know, it's just fun to, you know, hear people or read people's comments. Like on our shows that we do, I'll read through the comments and sometimes I'll chime in. If somebody says something extra dumb, I might add something extra dumb back, just extra absurdity, which I love. I love absurdity and stupidity. So it makes me laugh and there's nothing better. So if I find an extra mutant, then maybe I'll chime in. But, most of the time, it's like everybody, you know, they correct themselves. Like if somebody starts talking mad stuff about anybody, there's other people who will be like, you're totally wrong because of this. And so we have a really cool fan base. Yeah. And also, I look at our fan base as incredibly intelligent. Like I look at other comments on other shows, and it's just like, where are these people coming from? They can barely speak or spell. So I'm very happy with the people who actually are our base, and the people, it takes time to be like, I'm going to chime in and write a question about something, or I have a comment. So that's somebody taking time out of their day. And I'd say like, I give it like a 80% of our group of people who write in are really intelligent. So.
And I like that a lot of them self-police the comment totally. Sections themselves. They're like, hey, if someone says something that's either offensive or whatever, they actually say something about it.
Yeah, we all get it. Natasha's beautiful. She's not going to marry you. But it's nice that you mentioned, like, I can't wait for Natasha to finally realize that I'm here. So.
All right, what's next?
Jeff Kimball asks, what is Schnepp's creative process like? What does he do to get into maker mode?
To get into the what mode?
Maker mode.
Watch a bunch of maker videos.
Tutorials.
Trisha Scrambles is the one that I watch the most. To get into a creative mode for myself, sometimes it'll be just a random thought that I had about a project that I'm, you know, in development on, and I'll write it into my phone. Thankfully, we have phones now that have these notes apps where I used to always carry around a little small notepad with me, and it would be in my back pocket, and I would like write down some trigger words for myself. Sometimes I wouldn't write out a whole paragraph. It might be like, you know, the thing that made me think of this was this, this, and this, and then here's the thing. So then when I go back to it a day or a week later, that is how my process works. I mean, like, these trigger words bring my mind back to that moment when I thought of the thing, and then it's all fresh there. And usually I try to do that when I'm in front of my computer where I can write it all out. I don't try to bring back trigger words when I'm like, ah, we're all drinking, we're at a bar. This is, I'm not going to get to this. Yeah. And it gets washed away. So that's one of my processes. And then the other one is like when I actually am ready to, you know, get creative or do stuff, sometimes I will just write out like a series of whatever comes right out of my mind. It's stream of consciousness. Because if you're thinking about something, say you're thinking about like, I want to make a science fiction film about a space age Bigfoot, you know, that lives inside the moon, you know, you're like, all right, that's weird. So where would I start that? Would I start with a Bigfoot waking up, you know, inside the moon? Or would I start with someone else telling someone else about a Bigfoot that lives inside of the moon? I'd probably go with that. I'd go with like someone else telling someone else about a Bigfoot that lives inside the moon. The other dude's like, dude, you're crazy. That's insane. First of all, I don't even believe in Bigfoot. So it would be like this whole process, this whole story. And I would just write all that out. And then maybe none of that would actually even be in the, I'd throw all that away, but that would start some kind of creative process to get to Bigfoot inside the moon and what's going to happen. So sometimes those things, or I come up with scenes. That's another thing. Like, I don't even know where this scene goes, but organically, because of all the projects that I'm working on, it's going to go somewhere. So it'll fit somewhere. So that's the other thing, is like, don't be afraid if you're coming up with creative things. You don't necessarily need to know where a cool scene or a cool character or a cool idea fits in any of the things, because ultimately you're in your own mind, and all the things that you're thinking of will eventually collate and become what something of like, oh, this ended up becoming part of this TV show, or this was ended up becoming part of another person's story that they're telling at a bar. It's like all those things. I've definitely, the most important thing is to get it and record it and write it down so that you can get to the actual kernel of it. That's what I'm saying.
All right, what's next?
Alan Michael Kumbis asks, how was the transition to Collider, and how do you make editing not boring?
Well, transition to Collider was actually a lot smoother than I expected. I mean, for a little while, we were kind of in a limbo state.
Right.
I mean, during that time when John had left and we were still at AMC, it was a little crazy because, like, you know, we didn't know what was going on. But right. Once we actually started making the transition, it actually was pretty smooth.
Yeah, it literally was like a weekend. I think it was the July 4th weekend. And I remember the only thing I said to Campia, I was like, dude, just paint that red, make it green. That's all I said. I was like, and he was like, you know, you're right. That is, and of course, a lot more happened than that. But it was like, that's how I remember the transition. We went from red to green. It was like literally like that. And Collider has been nothing but awesome. I think it's opened up so many more doors for all of us to be able to talk about more things than just movies. We love talking about movies, but we've been able to expand into doing after shows about TV shows. Yes. All my heroes show now, they I talk about
comic books.
Comic books and movies and TV and how they all work together. It's a hybrid. So working with Collider.com has actually been a really cool transition, and it's been, for the most part, really smooth. I mean, a lot of the ideas of like doing list videos and all of us kind of coming up with more stuff to do for Collider has been really met with like no resistance and really like open arms. So it's, and it's great to work with Frosty. I mean, his team at Collider.com. I've known Steve for many years just as a nerd. I'm like, oh yeah, you're that bald dude that I see at this, at these conventions. We're always getting drunk at some party at like the, what is that rock and roll, the one that we like normally go to at San Diego Comic Con?
IGN.
Yeah, so the IGN party is always great. But I, you know, you see all these people year after year, and then finally you're like, oh my God, I'm working with this dude now. Technically, he's kind of my boss. Whatever, Frosty. I don't have to listen to you, but
don't tell me how to live my
don't
life.
Don't tell me about what I have to do. Frosty's like, you have to do this. All right. So anyway, it's been very smooth transition, and gotta thank Campia for making it so smooth. Honestly, like the way things went with AMC was like very rocky for a little bit, but actually it smoothed out. AMC became really cool. Everything kind of was weird for a little minute, but Campia was the one who actually kind of was able to keep this entire team together. So hats off to that dude.
And then in terms of making editing not boring, it really depends on what you're editing. Right. I mean, some stuff I edit, it's like, oh, you know. But if it's something you're actually really into, then it's not boring. And I get excited when I'm like, shoot, if I shot something that I really am into and I'm editing it, like, I actually enjoy the process. Right. But if you're editing, like, I don't know, 8 hours of some lecture about some, I don't know, something that you have no passion about, then you can get boring.
Or porn. Editing porn is really boring. But you know, keeping things creative and fun with editing, it's all in your brain. You know, it's like, hey, I have to edit these four different shots of all these people. It's like, how do I keep that alive? It's like, that's what you're watching right now. Jonathan's editing us, and it's like, pops to me, might pop to a three shot. It's on him. Like, all right, we're on Schnepp long enough. Let's pop back to that three shot. He's almost done rambling on. Mm-hmm. Bam, we're on a three shot. Oh, I think Dennis might be asking Natasha, what's that next question? You know, it's a natural thing. Like, while you're editing and you're on the fly, like what he's doing, it becomes natural. So it becomes a thing where it's like, it's kind of fun where you're rocking and rolling. And when you're doing footage like you were talking about, when things come together, where you're like, oh my God, that's a seamless thing. You're proud of that moment because you thought of it, you did that kind of thing. That's how you keep it fun.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
Sammy Murphy asks, favorite moment at Collider?
I mean, are we talking like, okay, Collider or just our whole AMC Collider stuff? I mean, we haven't been at Collider that long. What has it been, 6 months maybe?
July. So July, August, September, October, November, December, January. So this is our seventh month.
Yeah. But I mean, with AMC, I've been with AMC for this whole production, right. I guess, if you want to say AMC and Collider, for many, many years. Right. I mean, one of my favorite moments was just doing that 24-hour marathon.
That's right. All those people out there who paid for me to do those drawings, I have them almost done. I know I've been promising for, you know, years now. It's actually literally years. But I wanted to make sure they all get sent out at the same time. I have, like, I think there's like 13 of them completely done. And because we've had a changeover in some of the staff since we did that, that's the last two that I'm kind of stuck on. Is like, it's a lot of people who are part of our show that aren't part of our show. And I'm like, I don't know whether I should just change them now. And like, you know, that's a weird thing, but that's honestly the real honest truth as to why it's like hanging me up. It's been hanging me up for a couple months now. Like, how do I finish these? Maybe I'll just have to finish them and we'll figure it out. So, that's one of my favorite moments, was doing that 24-hour freak out, no sleep type of thing. What's the dude from, Jonathan's pal, the tall dude. I think his name's also John. Green.
John Green.
Yeah, John Green. All right. I got his name right. I was like, but what's his nickname?
Oh, so call him Soul.
Soul, right. See, that's what always throws me off when people are like, you know, my name's Bob Skippy, but you could call me Peanuts. I'm like, no, I don't remember any of your names. You have too many names. But I remembered it. So, yeah, hanging out with him, like 2:30 in the morning, hanging out with you. I remember when Campia was like, I'm not going to sleep. And we're like, get out of here, dude. Yeah. You're crazy. Go sleep on that couch. much. And he wouldn't take a break, and we finally forced him to, and he was like out for like 3 hours or something. He was like, I'll just sleep for 20 minutes. Like, you're crazy. You need sleep now. But it was like, literally, we were saying mad stuff. I can't even remember some of the stuff we were saying because we're so tired.
We were delirious.
Yeah, delirious. That's what happens. And talking nonstop. It was very fun, though, I have to say.
It was fun. I mean, I guess if I had to think of one moment at Collider, I actually thought our holiday party was pretty cool because that was the first time that a lot of us were able to meet, especially with the recap shows and the after shows, like a lot of new people meeting each other.
Totally.
I forget because I'm always here and I meet everyone and interact with everyone. I forget everyone else hasn't.
Totally, you're right. That Collider party was great. I learned that I suck completely at a hospital or what it's called.
Operation
Holly is like some kind of like weird master. Zen master of that stuff. I was like, I'm out. I can't do this, you know?
All right, what's next?
Taylor Burns asks, how do you deal with crazies?
Most of the time you just ignore them, I'd say.
Yeah.
Ignoring them.
They go away if you ignore them. Because crazies operate on that fuel of like, you know, your responses.
Don't
I mean, once
the
in
crazies.
A while. Yeah, once in a while I make the mistake of engaging them and then it goes into crazy land. But the best way is ignoring them.
Yep.
All right, what's next?
Faustino Lopez asks, what other passions aside from movies do you guys have?
I love eating.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like the highlights of my day are usually, what are we going to do for lunch? Right now, what time is it? It's like 3:07. I haven't eaten lunch yet.
Right.
I'm going a little loopy myself here, but I'm looking forward to getting something to eat.
Yeah, and where we are, which we cannot disclose the location, has a lot of really good places to eat. So we usually have a really good choice of places to go to, all in walking distance. So don't start trolling on where we're at, somewhere in Los Angeles. But yeah, for myself, I've got a lot of different interests. Obviously, I love comic books. Aside from movies, I love TV shows. I like to go to see comedy shows. A lot of my friends are comedians, so I'll break off sometimes and go check out a bunch of different comedy shows. I used to go to a lot more improv shows than I do now. Like if you cut to me like 5 years ago, I was going to a lot of improv shows, like at once a week sometimes. And now my life has gotten so busy doing this kind of stuff that it's like I've cut some, you know, it's back and forth. Also with going to rock concerts and live shows, used to do that a lot more, but I'm still going to a bunch of shows. I just got tickets for, you know, a couple shows. I could tell you I'm going to go see The Soft Moon. If you don't know who they are, check them out. I'll be going to see that concert and some other upcoming concerts. So I do that. How about you, Natasha?
Well, I grew up dancing, so dance is one of my biggest passions. But I actually have been playing piano since I was 9. So that's like my little therapy that I get to do whenever I get some free time at
home.
That's
awesome.
Yeah.
We got to get a mini piano in here.
Yeah, a little mini piano, a little concert.
What if we got like the cheapest, weird, like $9 Casio? Could you be like, I'm rocking it out? Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
And she starts singing these like super depressing songs.
I want to see that. Like, I'll film that and throw it on. I'm going to periscope that. That is actually going to be a new bit. I'm going to bring in a Casio. I want you to sing the most depressing songs possible. Periscope,
start looking
son.
At my repertoire.
It's happening. That'll be awesome.
All right, what's next?
Okay, Frostino has another question. Do you guys ever want to direct or produce live action films in the future?
Yes. Direct, yes. Produce, no. I mean, you know, when you do smaller projects, you have to produce them. And I actually think I'm do a decent job at producing. I hate producing. Can't stand it. Don't like it. A lot of paperwork, a lot of organizing, a lot of that crap. I'd rather focus on more of the creative stuff. So, yeah, I would like to direct a movie or a television show or, you know, I'm working on a web series, just anything.
Sure. For myself, directed a lot of I've done a few TV shows and I've done mainly cartoons for like the last 15 years, a lot of Adult Swim stuff. Directing a feature film is next on my list. You know, I love producing. Like I like producing other people's projects. I helped. I'm executive producing a pal of mine, Alan Amato's documentary called Temple of Art. And so that really was just kind of helping raise money for him, maybe helping answer a few questions here and there. It's really been like, it depends like on how much somebody wants to lean on me is like, if I'm producing something, how much, or if I'm EPing something, how much do they want me involved? Sometimes if I'm producing someone else's project, it's like just kind of like setting things up and then letting them go, you know, like letting them happen. So I like it. Definitely like the some of the more boring things that you mentioned about producing, I don't like, but that's a great
paperwork.
Thing. Paperwork. Paperwork. But that's a good thing. Is
paperwork.
Like, if you have a bunch of producers with you, there's like line producers, you know, production managers, all different, you know, all different kinds of titles that all kind of delve into some of those other things. There's other people who love doing paperwork. You want to make sure that you keep them around and hire them.
Let me know who those people are.
I will.
I'd love to meet them.
I will.
Roz from Monsters, Inc.
I will give you a couple of names if you need those those people. But yeah, producing and directing is definitely a very fun thing that I enjoy doing, and it's a creative outlet, so I'll be doing more of it in the future.
Okay, let's take one more question. We have a lot more, but maybe we'll save those for another show. We got one question from someone we know.
All right.
Chris
Gore asks, a question for Schnepp. Will you give Chris Gore the $25 you owe him on camera for losing the $100 million bet?
Absolutely. The reason I made $100 million bet. It wasn't a $100 million bet. It was a $25 bet that Deadpool will make. I said it will make over $100 million on its opening weekend. It's an R-rated, hard R comedy. I know it's not going to make $100 million. I want it to make $100 million. And sometimes if you just use your power of will, like the Force, that it possibly could happen. And you put that out there, like I'm putting it out there right now when you go see Deadpool and tell all your friends to see Deadpool, that it possibly could break 100 million. A lot of people are like, it's going to be 70 or 60 or 50. Gore's more like, he was like more in the $40 or $50 million range. Watch, he'll go up to like 70, 75 later. But so he was like, it'll be under. And we made that bet while I was in Florida. We made it at our like Heroes panel that we did. And totally, I'll do it. I have no problem losing. To me, it's like a win-win situation. I think, number one, I want the film to be great. I want it to be funny. So that's the first part. The second part is, wouldn't it be great if it was, even if it made $70 million? That's great, because I think the budget for it was like 45 or something like that.
Like 35, 38.
So for it to even be able to make $70 million opening weekend bodes well for adult films for adults that are R-rated, just like The Matrix when it was R-rated when it came out, and that was a smash hit that helped usher in some more films that people were willing to take chances on because they're like, there is a market for adults. So I think that's what I think Ryan Reynolds is saying. Well, like, I hope this means that when we do X-Force, we can make that R-rated, you know? So it's sort of one of those things, like, I will totally give you that $25 when I lose Chris Gore. But
yes,
you'll have to give me that $25.
If I have to be honest, I have a feeling that you will be giving Chris Gore $25. Yeah.
Thank God it was just $25, yes. Man.
Whew. All right, guys. So that's it for this episode of Collider Mailbag. Thanks for everyone who sent in questions. I wish we could get to all of them, but there's like still a ton more. Maybe we'll do another show next week. Maybe Campy will be sick next weekend. we'll do another one. Right. I want to thank the people joining me today. Natasha, where can people find you?
You guys can find me on Instagram at Natasha A. Martinez and on Twitter at NatashaLexis_.
Schnepp.
You guys can follow me just on Instagram and Twitter, just at John Schnepp. Check out my show here that we do here at Collider. It's called Collider Heroes. Gore is a part of that. We got Burnett, Robert Meyer Burnett, the Hot Toys Freak. We got lots of sweat coming from Umberto Gonzalez, Amy Dallin. A whole bunch of regulars are on the show, and we have occasional guest stars. Campia is going to be coming back. John Campia is with me on it. It's a really fun show where we get all sweaty about comic books, comic book culture, movies, and television, all based off superheroes and villains. So Collider Heroes, you got to check that out. Talking about the death of Superman Lives, what happened? Go to TDOSLWH.com and pick up my film, get a digital download, get the 8 hours extra crazy madness. Thanks.
And you guys can find me on Twitter at ThinkHero, on Instagram, Dennis.TZNG. I want to thank Jonathan in the back over there, who's been switching our show for the last... Yeah.
Doing it live, son. Watch some of this magic switch and go for it. Yo, 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 yo. That's what can happen, son, when you're editing.
And don't forget to subscribe to this channel, youtube.com/collidervideos. And we'll see you guys on Movie Talk tomorrow.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.